Hey y'all, I'm Kimberly Warner, mama of two, lover of shoes, and serial entrepreneur. I've dedicated my life to helping women succeed in business by just being themselves. But the path isn't always easy. We have all gone through challenges and fear, but it is through those times when we learn who we really are, authentically. This podcast is for anyone who has experienced fear or is looking for the inspiration to do more, be more, or like me, rise from the ashes and be better than before. Here we go. Hey, y'all, we're back for another episode of Fearlessly Authentique. I'm your host, Kimberly Warner. Today, we are in studio again, and not only with one guest, but two guests. It's a super morning because we're also having mimosas. Yay! Clink, clink, clink. So I get to welcome not only one fabulous woman, but two. First is Julie Vail. Julie Vail lives in Sheboygan area, and she is a proud veteran, conservative activist, and works as a leader in IT for Acuity Insurance. And she brought her most beautiful, wonderful daughter, who I don't know how old you are. How old are you? Do you mind saying?
No, I don't mind. I'm 32.
32. So she's just a baby, Jenna Lenski. And Jenna also is following in her mom's footsteps. And we're going to get a little bit more into that. And we're going to have her tell a little bit about her background and what she's doing. But the reason that we wanted to bring these two fabulous women to you is that May is National Military Appreciation Month. And we are so happy to have you here and so grateful for your service. So please welcome to Fearlessly Authentique Studios.
We're honored to be here. Thank you.
Yeah, we're so excited. So I'm going to start with Mom. Tell us a little bit about your background and yourself and just how military became like your family's legacy.
I was in high school and they always ask you, what are you going to be when you graduate? And I thought, I want to go where I can make a difference. I want to go see the world. I want to do something. I want to explore.
Okay.
And I thought the military checked all those. Plus, all I could go to college, too.
Right.
It would pay for my college. And I thought it would be a great thing to do and serve my country as well.
Okay. So you joined what arena?
I joined the Air Force.
Okay.
And the funny thing about that is when I took the ASVAB, the test, I was
ASVAB, that sounds like something I have like in my jeans right now. Sorry, I couldn't help myself there. It's not even the mimosa kicking
in yet.
It's just my natural personality. So ASVAB must be some sort of a test that you take.
Yes.
Okay. It's a military aptitude test. Yeah.
Okay, aptitude to see where you're at and where you would most be successful within the military.
Where I would fit in. The Navy had asked for me. They came to my house. The Marines thought I would do well. And the Army said, it's only 10 weeks. And I thought, no.
Okay.
So I went into the Air Force recruiter and I said, how long is your basic training? And they said, it's only 6 weeks plus this, this, and this. Oh, yeah, I'm there.
Okay.
I can do 6 weeks.
Okay. And how old are you at this time?
Just I was 18.
Right out of high school. Okay.
And so I thought, well, 6 weeks isn't so bad. I can do 6 weeks. I can survive 6 weeks.
So you get through basic training and you start in the Air Force. And what is your specialty? What do you do?
I was an administrative assistant.
Okay.
More like a glorified secretary. But I loved it. It was great. It was fun. There was 50% men, 50% women. My commander was a female, but it was unusual. There aren't so many female commanders at that time.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, there weren't as many females in leadership positions at that time.
Okay. And that's changed, I would imagine, right, Jenna?
I mean, it has changed. We've got a long way to go. But I mean, from where my mom was at, I know that the females in leadership have increased significantly.
So as you are progressing your career and you do go through college, right, and you get that training, you're loving it. Now you're saying there's about half men, half women. So like there must have been some cute guys in.
No,
no,
just one.
I was going to say.
Oh, there it is.
I was about, you knew where I was going.
One.
You knew where I was going with this one, didn't you, Julie?
Yes.
So there was one really attractive guy, and what was he doing in the
Air Force? Was actually in transportation.
Okay.
And at that point in time, he was like a taxi service, and I was called to go from one squadron to another, and he would have to take me from point A to point B, and he always requested that he be my driver. And then after that, we got to be good friends. And I always wonder, why is he always my driver? Mm-hmm. But we got to get to know each other. And Jenna is the result of that.
Okay. Yeah. And so he ultimately became your husband.
Yes.
And his name is?
Reed.
Reed. Okay. Darling. And so you've been married how long?
30 years.
30 years. Well, congratulations.
Jenna, are you 30? Did we need to say you were?
I'm 32.
Okay, with 32 years.
Oh, 32. I love that when my mom does that too. She's like, how old are you?
Yeah, right.
And then she had four kids. So she's like, wait, what's your name again?
Right.
And how old are you?
Just give
and
you guys
like,
a number.
Yeah. Thanks, Mom. I really appreciate it. And so Jenna, you are 32. Mm-hmm. You are obviously the proud reproduction of your parents meeting in the Air Force. Are you just the only sibling?
No, it's me and my brother, Jared.
Okay.
So, and he's actually in the military as well.
Okay. And what is he, older or younger?
He's younger than I am.
Okay. And what does he do?
He's a flight engineer right now for a C-130 unit, and he's loving it. He loves being air crew.
That is so cool.
Yeah.
So you must be really proud of your mom. I mean, it's a huge thing to have, you know, everyone in your family, your whole family legacy, to be in the military service. So what made you, like, what led you to want to go into the military and tell us about, you know, your start and what you do?
Yeah, so obviously my parents' service is inspirational to me to join the military, but I got to be honest with you, the reason I joined the military was because graduation was coming and my dad was like, either you go to college and pay for it yourself or you join the military. And I was like, I have no money. So the military was the natural step for me. He brought me down to his unit, which is in Milwaukee, and I got to know it. It was really, I think, the best decision I could have ever made for myself. But yeah, I went into it for the school benefits, and it really worked out for me because I thought I was going to do my 6 years and get out, and here I am 14 years later, closer to my 20. So
wow.
Yeah.
So what was your school focus? Like, what was your focus when you were there?
Well, I wanted to go into pre-dental, but I found out quickly that I was not good at science or math, and
And also cleaning other people's teeth is gross.
Right?
Like, kudos to every dental hygienist out there. Just saying, especially post-COVID, people have not gone to the dentist in like over a year, you know?
That would be me too,
like, because you couldn't get in, you know what I mean? So, like, kudos to all the dental hygienists out there, especially post-2020. So you found out that was not what you were calling.
Right. And so I did really well in some speech classes, and my communications instructors were like, have you ever thought about going into communications? And I hadn't, but then, of course, you know, going through college and the journalism classes really just stuck out to me. And of course, every girl wants to be a marketer and, you know, whatever. And now in today's age, it's turned into influencer or whatever. But
yes,
the line of communications for me has been awesome. I love it. And I think that was definitely the right call for me. So not only did I major in journalism and communications, but I also have deviated my military track to pursue those kinds of things too. So I'm in the public affairs career field. And I started out in operations, really. It was a good start. It definitely taught me about the military. It taught me about the flying culture. And it gave me a good foundation for working with this unit. And then I had networked my way into the public affairs section and eventually commissioned as an officer. So I'm a public affairs officer.
So does that mean that then you are in charge of recruiting events and things like that? Or what does it mean in terms of public affairs? What do you do on like an average day?
So the way I describe public affairs and recruiting, because we work very closely together, but public affairs is meant to inform and recruiting is meant to persuade. The second you put a call to action on any message from public affairs, it turns into recruiting material, which is marketing material. And public affairs really is, like, think of it as the wings or the installation's news agency. So we tell them our story. We tell them our mission. We work with the press and get them editorial and get them media operations and community relations. So it's a really fun way to involve the community in the media and garner that public trust and support.
That sounds like fun job.
Yeah,
like, that sounds
super
like fun. Like every day. But now I know y'all both had some scary experiences, right? Back.
Just one.
So, and okay, so I'm going to let you tell it because I try to synopsis it and then I usually like mess it up. But so you both had kind of an intense experience with fire on your bases when you were stationed abroad.
Yes.
Tell us about that.
During the Gulf War in Turkey, we were. When you come in, you're given an in-briefing, and then you're taught how to use chemical warfare gear, put on the mask, put on the chemical warfare gear, your suit, put the shoes on. we were supposed to do it under 2 minutes. And one day, a siren came over the base, and it was just don your gear ASAP. What had happened is we had friendly fire that accidentally dislodged its missile, and we had no idea where it was going. Fortunately, it went to a nearby farmer's field, but at the time of the siren, we all donned our gear, and I promise you, I did mine in 1 minute.
Nice job. Nice job, Julie.
I was scared. and then I had at that time, Jenna was 3 years old, I had a picture of her in a ceramic frame, and I bumped my desk just enough for it dropped onto the floor and it broke.
Oh,
but
no.
I quick grabbed it and I held on to it, and I just thought of my daughter, and I was praying, and I thought, dear God, help me get through this. And that's what got me through.
Yeah.
Just a picture of her and hope.
Yes.
Just all that hope, like, wow, I hope I get through this.
Mm-hmm.
And it did. We got the all clear. I might have been the first one down, but I was definitely the last one up.
So, and that picture and that hope and your faith is what got you through that scary moment. And when you were telling that story, that it kind of brought me back to like 9/11 and wondering what those people had felt like.
Yeah.
And I would imagine that probably that same sort of grab that a picture of the loved one and pray and hope and, you know, that feeling, no matter what situation you're in, whether it's a 9/11 or friendly fire, false alarm situation, it's still scary. And I think people who go through anything like that can finally kind of understand a little bit about maybe what those people were feeling, you know, that day.
And you don't know. And, you know, 9/11, when that had occurred, I was in my car driving to a college class, and I thought, I should go back in. And I thought, oh, those men and women, I just prayed for them because I just knew something was going to come from that. So, So that is also inbuilt into me.
Yes.
But 20 years later, Jenna goes through the same thing almost.
Yeah. So now what happens to you?
Well,
similar story with fire, but, and you were also stationed where?
I was actually in Qatar for 6 months, and then I forward deployed to Afghanistan. And so,
okay, so just for those of us that are geographically challenged, like myself, where is Qatar?
Oh man, Qatar is in the Middle East. It's a very teeny tiny country. It's like by Saudi Arabia, and I think across the water is probably Iran.
Okay.
So, yeah.
All right. Okay. So you were there first, and then you were transferred to Afghanistan.
Right. And so I was at Kandahar Air Base, and doing some public affairs work there, and mine's not that traumatic. It's crazy. I was actually in the shower, and
and the fire alarm went off.
Well, I heard
and
a
you
lot
ran
of commotion.
No.
Right. It was pretty close. I just stopped, and I, you know, put on all my clothes, and of course, I don't have my battle rattle with me. So then I've got to, you know, run down to where that is.
Okay, again, real quick, battle rattle. I don't know what that is.
Yeah. So, I mean, we always have our weapons with us, obviously, but we don't take like our helmet and our bulletproof vest or flak vest or whatever. And I didn't have any of that stuff with me. So that's called
battle rattle.
Right. All of the equipment altogether.
That's such a cute name for such really heavy, large, scary
it
crap.
Is.
When you think about it, it's pretty scary stuff.
It is.
But I know they do train you to respect your weapon and don't you even have to sleep with it in like basic training in the beginning? Because I have a friend, Stacy, whose son is going through it right now. They really do train you to respect your weapon. And that's something that is always with you, right?
Yes. And that's for accountability. I mean, you can't leave a weapon anywhere. And when we were in Afghanistan, we were working with the Afghans. So, I mean, like, you don't know who's who. And if you leave a weapon unattended, you are accountable for it if anything were to ever happen to it. So, yeah, our weapons are always with us. And so the weapon was with me. That was fine. But, again, I didn't have the rest of that equipment. So I quick tied my hair up in a bun and ran downstairs to wherever I was going and went into the shelter and stuff. But at the end of the day, it was a mortar that just kind of came over. What I was told was that occasionally, you know, the Taliban would set those up and just really let you know that we're still in the area, we're still here. It went into no man's land. It didn't hit anything or anything. But, I mean, the experience was still kind of crazy because I had no idea what was going on.
Weren't you terrified? Like, scared? Like, my doorbell rings in the middle of the night and I'm like, WTF? Who is ringing my doorbell? And then I'm like, everybody get down. Everybody get under the bed. You know what I mean? Like, somebody's ringing the doorbell. And when I say at night, that's like 8:30 because I go to bed really early. So, you know, right. It could have been like, oh, sorry, we were delivering the pizza to the wrong house. But were you not just like terrified? I would have been just out of my mind scared.
Oh my gosh, it's so funny how the military trains you, because you don't have time to be scared because you know you have to be somewhere, and if you're not somewhere, you'll get in trouble. And I'm like, you know, in my mind, I'm more scared of getting in trouble by somebody. I'm not in the right place at the right time. So Okay. Yeah, you kind of put it to the back of your mind. And I didn't hear anything detonate. I didn't hear the weapon go off. All I heard was the siren. So at that point in my mind, I'm like, obviously something has already happened, mm-hmm. but you don't know if there's going to be follow-up after right. it or anything. So the main focus is to getting to whatever shelter you need to be in and right. with your squad or whatever.
And with clothes on.
With clothes on, yes, yeah. exactly.
Just because you were in the shower. Right. So, just like, so now I see a ring on your finger as well.
Yes.
Did you meet you're married or engaged?
I am married.
Okay.
Yes.
Did you meet your husband in the military as well?
What is so cool is that I did not. I met him in college. We went to Stevens Point together.
Ah, that's where I went to grad school.
Oh, that's so awesome. No, I loved Point. Ultimately, we both transferred from there and came down to schools in Milwaukee, but he is an RN and I'm in the military.
Oh, great.
And so we've always had like this, you know, this social structure, like shift in our marriage and everything. And it's worked out so awesome. When we first got together, I told him, you know, I'm in the military and I made the commitment to the military first before I met you. And so he has been an amazing support system for me, always supported what I've done. He's gone through trainings. He's gone through deployments. He's gone through it all. So
yeah, that's
just
a lot.
Crazy.
That's a lot.
It's a lot.
It's like you're married to Jesus, then you're married to the
military,
and then you're married to your husband.
Right.
What's his name?
Steve.
Oh, yeah. I have a Steve too. There he is.
They're good guys.
So do y'all have kids then yet?
Or? We do have one kid. Yeah.
Okay.
So I became a mom in 2019.
Oh, congratulations.
Yeah, thank you.
So you have a baby.
I do. Yeah. It's been so fun. And so now it's just kind of funny to see things come full circle. You know, when my mom was in the military and she had to leave me for those orders.
Right.
You know, there's
15 months.
Yeah. There's a huge gap in
months.
Care.
And yeah. And so do you have a boy or a girl?
A boy.
Okay. And how old is he then?
He'll be 2 in August.
Okay.
So
okay. What's his name? Do you care?
Oh, no. Theo.
Oh, I love that name.
Yeah.
That's so, cute.
You know, I think about her and I think about my deployment in 2018 when I had parents under my charge. And, you know, as a person, you don't know what it's like to be a parent. So
right.
like for me, I'm like, whatever, we're here to do our job. Everyone's got to do the same thing. And now as a mother, I'm like, I cannot believe the struggle those people must have gone through.
Yes.
And
so you don't have to leave anymore. And
at the time, I don't have to leave.
Okay.
I mean, so long as you're in the military, you're always subject to being activated.
So and have you ever been away from your son then for military?
Luckily, in these past 2 years, I have not.
Okay.
And, you know, I'm trying to think of what it would be like if I did get called up or if I had to go away for training or anything. Or even just a temporary duty, what we call TDYs, I don't like to be away from him for a weekend.
Right.
So, I mean, like, I really respect the military
away,
parents.
Just so you know,
yeah,
like,
right?
when they get older, like
okay.
12,
okay.
like my son, that does go, that
yeah,
missing, I don't want to be away from him for a weekend. That goes away.
Yeah.
Okay. So, Julie, did you ever have to go away from your kids
yes.
when you were serving?
Yes.
So how was that as a mom for you? I mean, and
yes,
dad was away too? Like,
no,
how did that work?
No, dad stayed with mom. Dad was home base
because okay.
he was in the missile field at this time.
Okay.
And Jenna was 3 years old when I left. So January 13th, I left
okay.
North Dakota, Grand Forks Air Force Base
okay.
to go to Turkey.
Okay.
And then January 22nd, she turned 3.
Mm.
And then that's when we went into full force from Operation Desert Shield to Operation Desert Storm.
Okay.
And so I had to leave her for a 15-month remote, which meant I would be away from her for 15 months.
How did you do that? And did you recognize her when you got back?
I did, for the love of God, yes.
I mean, because 15
but,
months
you know,
can change
oh,
a baby.
It was.
Know.
The way I had to stay in communication, though, back then.
Yes, I was going to say.
Was VHS. Do you remember VCRs and VHS?
Oh, yeah, girl.
We did tape. I would tape a book, and I would read the book, and then I would talk into the video tape recorder and
like, yep.
tell her how my week was.
Then would you have to mail
yes,
the VHS?
I did.
Okay, y'all, let me just put this in perspective. Yes. So, I mean,
we mailed it. It took at least 2 weeks.
Crazy. So for people in the military now, like, they can do, you know, the FaceTime, yes, and all that kind of stuff. What a blessing. What a,
yes,
gift.
Yes.
But for her to be away from you as a 3-year-old baby for 15 months and have to tape something on a VHS tape, put it and mail it to you so,
yes,
your dad could,
exactly,
open it up and let you watch it. Do you remember any of that at 3? Do you remember, like, your mom sending these videos, or like when she came home, you were like, I don't, who are you? Do you remember any of that?
I don't think I remember anything from then, but we have replayed the tapes. So, I mean, like, I do have childhood memories of watching my mom read me those books and stuff.
That's so cool. You still have them.
And she has this globe too. I left her with
a stuffed globe.
Yes, a stuffed globe.
Oh.
And daddy would tell her, this is where we are.
Yeah.
And this is where mommy is, and she will be coming soon.
So now Theo has the globe.
I love that.
Yeah, so it's been crazy. But I still have the letters that she sent me. And it's, you know, it's, I read them now and think, oh my God, mom, I can't believe you went through that, because that must have been so hard to write letters to a baby, you know, who can't read,
right,
who won't know what this means. And, you know, I'm hearing it from my dad's voice.
Yes.
So you go through a huge disconnect, especially, you know, being a female, being a mother leaving, it's,
right,
so different than being a father leaving.
Correct.
And
for a female child.
Yeah, absolutely.
Correct.
And so, you know, I'm a daddy's girl, obviously. And
right. Aren't they all?
Yeah,
yes,
right. But,
yes,
you know, I think that subconsciously that had something to do with it. You know, I don't remember if there was any, you know, hesitation when my mom came home or anything, but, mm-hmm, she was always been in my life, you know, growing up and stuff,
right,
like that. So, but having that year
stint, right,
where we weren't together, I can imagine was very hard on her. So
I think that what's so great about this story for other women
listening, you
know, amazing that you did that and served your country in that way. And amazing that, you know, as a little baby, you were doing everything you could to, mm-hmm, communicate to your baby, and your dad was giving it to you, and you still have it and you still read it today. I think the reason that you probably still want to read it is, like, that inspiration and that love and devotion is something that most kids don't get from their parents. You know what I mean? Like, I've never sat down and wrote a letter to Maddie at age 3, or any other age for that matter, really describing, like, you know, mommy misses you, can't wait to get home, that kind of thing.
Oh, yeah.
And so that's a really special gift to have, I think, from a parent. Mm-hmm. And maybe it's a kind of an eye-opening situation that all of the mothers out there listening, no matter how old your kid is right now, maybe you just,
yeah,
sit down and write, like, a little letter and seal it and give it to them when they're 15 or 16 or 18 or whatever milestone's important,
yeah,
to you. Because if you're still reading them how many
right,
years later? I mean, you're 32 and you were 3, so that's what, 29 years. That's a cool piece of something that,
yes,
you will have forever, as long as you're on God's green earth. So I think that's super cool.
Yeah.
I also think that the whole piece of being away and having to not be able to communicate, like, phone or anything,
oh, yeah,
like that.
Oh, yeah.
Must...
I couldn't pick up the phone or anything. Can you imagine, though, getting a call from my husband one day? I said, hi, honey, how you doing? And he said, like, oh, so how are your night going? Oh, by the way, Jenna's base was mortar attacked, but she's fine. She's okay.
Oh,
okay. Well, I got to go. I'll see you later.
So,
circling back to when Jenna had been not attacked,
but,
obviously.
But when that alarm went off.
Back memories.
Yeah.
Yes. And so I'm glad that she was okay, number one. But,
mm-hmm,
that was on a Thursday night. I didn't hear from Jenna until Saturday morning. So
yeah, the
for
fear.
Friday, I was like, I know she's okay, Lord, but could you just please have her coming right away?
Yeah.
Please, God. I gotta hear it from her.
And your son
yeah,
too now being,
oh, yeah,
more active duty, right? So is he?
He's still in the guard, but he is a little bit more active than all of us because he takes, you know, orders more frequently, being a flyer. But no, Jared did go through a lot too. He was deployed to Kuwait, and as an air crew member, he was going on runs in all kinds of countries throughout the Middle East. And, you know, especially when we had those attacks going on with, what was that, Syria?
Yeah.
A couple years ago.
Mm-hmm.
It got real crazy real fast. And so mom's experienced a lot,
oh,
being,
yeah,
a military mother.
Oh, yeah.
I mean,
she's
been stressed.
Both of them were deployed at the same place at the same time. But fortunately, one was down and one was up. One was sleeping, and then
we were on separate shifts. We were both
separate
in Qatar.
Separate shifts, but that you guys were... y'all were both in the same location,
right,
at least.
Right.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. So thank God they're together.
Right.
When
so
I
then
came
you
home,
just basically were awake 24 hours.
Yeah.
You just didn't sleep.
I was praying a lot. I was praying, let me tell you.
Yeah. So when I got off shift and Jared was just waking up, we could go eat breakfast together and we got to see each other. And then, you know, carry on. But
well, that's
kind of
cool. Like, mm-hmm. as adult siblings, very rarely do you get to do that with your siblings and your job. You know
right,
what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, it's unless, you know, you both work at the Gap or something. I don't know. But that is so. All right. So what do you think our listeners should know about our military and the brave men and women who serve? Like, if you could give everyone listening, like, you know, a one sentence thing, what would be the most important thing that you would want people to know about our military? And I mean, how hard you work.
My biggest thing that I would say is that we are just normal people. I mean, yeah, I've done a bunch of stuff and I'm in the military, but at the end of the day, I'm a stay-at-home mom right now.
Right.
You know, the military is my weekend gig. And I think that people are forgetful that, like, we're just normal people. For women especially, like, you either go both ends of the spectrum. Either they over-sexualize us and it's so sexy to be in the military, or
yes,
or we have to shave our heads and we're like, you know, just
G.I. Jane.
G.I. Jane.
Right.
And so I'm like, no, there's a middle ground. Like, I drink wine on the weekends with my girlfriend. I go to Target and spend money
right.
that I shouldn't be spending.
Correct.
You know what I mean? Like, we're just normal women.
Right.
But yeah. And so especially last year, you know, and I know that you were personally affected by everything that happened. But
yes.
when they activated the National Guard to do everything, I mean, those were my friends. I didn't get activated, but you know, my girlfriends went out there and they're stay-at-home moms, they're dental hygienists,
yep.
they're teachers. They're just like every other woman out there doing a separate duty apart from that too. So like just knowing that we're humans also is what
yes.
I would say.
And I got to meet a few of them, you know, throughout the course of just being downtown and whatnot. And of course, it was always like, you know, can we buy you drinks? Can we buy you dinner? Can we? And it was like, of course, they couldn't drink.
Right.
But I was like,
right.
well, can I buy you a lollipop? I don't know, something, you know, like
yeah.
a chocolate shake. What do you want? You know. But and for them to come in and just and they're actually just so quiet and so respectful, like you hardly even knew that they were there. But there were so many
right.
that were in our area, of course. And we were, and me especially, so grateful to see those trucks rolling in, because for me in particular, what happened in my downtown was something I've never witnessed before. And like I said on Fox News and other places, it looked like a war zone. There was a, you know, a car dealership that all the cars were completely burned to skeletons, and I would call it the graveyard. You know, thankfully all of that stuff is gone and there's new cars there and
yes.
you know, the boards are down for the most part. But it was a very scary and long year despite the COVID. So we definitely were so very grateful to see y'all come in and feel for a minute that we didn't have to be scared. Because some of the things that I saw happening live, you know, via everybody's phones and skateboarding around and the, you know, the different news outlets that were there and stuff. I mean, there are things I close my eyes and still see that I never want to see again. Things
yeah.
I never thought I would see as a civilian in my life. Things that y'all probably
yeah.
have seen, but I have not. And those are memories that are so awful. But then the memory of all the trucks coming in, it was just a moment of relief.
Yeah.
And so for us civilians and, you know, everyday people, we still look at you with reverence, because no matter what level you are in or what you do, it's still, that's why I think people think of you like not as a normal person, because
right.
it's still something that we can't fathom ever doing. And if they've ever experienced like me what we did, it was such a relief to see y'all come in. And so I think that's a big piece of it, too. Mm-hmm. But it is good to know that you are a normal person and you,
yeah.
drink wine.
Yes, yes.
Thankfully, you drink today, because I was all about Tuesday mimosas.
Yep.
I mean, we had to twist your mom's arm a little bit.
I know.
We got her to join
in.
What would you say, Julie, if there was one thing that you could have, like, everyone know about the military, like something that
is... It is a great way of life. It really is. And it helps you balance, you know, keep things in mind, and your everything about the military is either positive or negative. You can take away from what away from it what you want. But in the long run, the military is a good way of life. And I would recommend it to women in whatever career field they choose. Almost every career field is open to women now.
Yeah.
Almost back in my day, it was unheard of where there were women fighters or there were women pilots. But now, Jenna, would you say that they're more in common now?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, in the Air Force alone, I think it's probably 50-50. I mean, women are still a small percentage of the military overall. I think like 18 to 20%. But as far as the career fields go, they're all very, very split between male and female.
Yeah.
I think it's so great. And especially for my listeners, no matter what side of the fence and the spectrum, you know, that you are in terms of politics, we still have to respect the country, respect the flag, respect the office, and respect the military for all that they do, you know, day in and day out. You know, there are things that are happening and people that aren't sleeping and we don't even know about it. People away from their kids, you know, we're not, you know, if we're not friends with those people, we don't know what they're going through. But for you guys to share this is so enlightening. Is there anything that you guys would maybe, like, what kind of advice? Is there anything our listeners could do to help support our veterans and those that are in active service?
I will give this. And this is what I say whenever I've been asked to be a speaker. Whenever you say the Pledge of Allegiance, remember, a pledge is a vow. It's a promise. It means I will. And allegiance is more than steadfast loyalty. It means commitment to a cause or a group. So when you say the Pledge of Allegiance, say it with respect.
And reverence.
And you look at your flag and remember, don't burn the flag. Don't tear it up. Don't drag it around. Don't spit on it. Respect the flag. Don't disgrace the flag. And when you respect the flag, you will remember the men and women who served the flag and who died for our flag.
That is so true. In fact, my flag is brand new because the one I had sort of ripped through the years, you know, could just be in the wind and it tore. And so Steve and I took it down. And Steve also was in the military. He was in the Navy. And so he taught me how we like
folded it.
Yeah, together the correct way so that I could keep it in place of reverence. But I do believe that for the younger generation, whether they say it in school or they don't say it in their school, I feel like it should be more commonplace, that it should be more part of our American culture. I don't know how we do that if they aren't doing it in school. I'm not really sure how we get that out there. And maybe it's a whole
the
social
Pledge
media.
Of Allegiance needs to be said. And you need to say it with reverence.
I agree. With reverence and respect. But, you know, maybe it's a social media platform or something to try. Because I don't know if my kids say it at their school or not. I don't think that they say it, which makes me wonder, do my kids even know it? And then now that falls on you as a parent. And so I think it's a good message to remember that as a parent, maybe if they don't do it at school, maybe you just do it at your own house and kind of teach them, which my kids do have. I mean, they bought me that for Christmas. They do have a very large respect for the flag and what it means. But what would you say if you could say what anything that we could do, the listeners could do for active or retired military?
Yeah, I mean, I guess I would say this is to take an interest in what it is they're thanking us for. I mean, every Veterans Day, every Armed Forces Day, we get thank you for your service. Thank you for your service. And, you know, my general response is, well, thank you for your support. Mm-hmm. And then I'm wondering, do they know exactly what they're supporting us for? You know what I mean? So there's a quick story I had when I came home from my my long deployment. My family threw a party for me, like a welcome home party. And my mother-in-law was like, oh, you know, you should get up and say, you know, thank you for coming to your party. And I was like, yeah, I can say that. I remember going up there saying, thank you for coming and thank you for taking care of my family, blah, blah, blah. And I started talking about what I was doing over there. And I was like, you know, it really comes down to knowing what we're doing over there, taking an interest in it. You know, you're supporting us and this is your taxpayer, your taxpayer dollars at work.
Right.
I just got so mad and I like blacked out because I'm like, you know, Americans don't know what we're doing over there. They don't know world politics and, you know, they don't know our everyday struggle. And for me, it was like, they're not going to know that because you went over there and experienced it, so they can't know it. But I think just like taking an interest, you know, in what's happening. And even if you're not listening to the news, I mean, go and research those countries that we're in. I learned so much about Afghanistan. I learned so much about Qatar and Turkey when I was over in all those countries. And it really made me respect and have a lot of sympathy for what's happening in the Middle East. You know, the Qatari women, the Afghan women, I looked at all of their struggles and Man, I'm so thankful for the experience I had to help out those kinds of countries. But I think for Americans, take an interest in what it is that you're thanking us for.
Yeah, I love that. It is a lot to understand, but to take the time to really understand what it is that you do and not just have it be a blanket thank you. But Right. We do thank you for your
thank
service.
You.
And you guys, you know, giving today like a little glimpse in has been really fun and incredible. I always have to end the podcast with like a fun question. And so I kind of prepped you guys. But so if you were Oprah and you could give your favorite thing to everyone in the world, whether it's $2 or $20,000. It can be something you use every day. It can be something small, big, something you covet that you don't have but you wish you had and could give to everyone. Do you guys have an item like that? Something that you would give?
I actually do. I would recommend getting a survival garden in which not only can you...
Oh my God, take, Mom.
Yes.
What? I love it because I don't know what survival garden is.
It's where you have your basic food that it'll help you grow your vegetables and herbs and whatnot. But it also gives you time to think and meditate and give you some downtime.
So are you like building the garden yourself or like is there like
we'll
you can order
you
it online?
Area.
Like can you get it on Amazon?
What's going on?
So you mean actually build a small garden of your, okay.
Yeah. It could either be a flower garden or a vegetable garden or a rock garden even.
Okay.
But somewhere to go out and meditate and breathe in your fresh air.
I like
but then,
that.
If it's a vegetable garden, then you have something to grow food from.
I would need you to give that to me because I don't have a green thumb. My friend Nova's going to help me build a rock garden, but I know my friend Kara, who owns Milliger's right over here, would love to hear that you just said everybody needs their own survival garden. I love that one. That's one of the most innovative and interesting answers we've gotten so far. Now, that's no pressure to Jenna, but...
Yeah, mine's not like that in depth. I was really like, if we're talking about products, and I'm not an affiliate or anything, but I have to start working out because with COVID and everything, we took a break in PT testing and now we've got to start up PT tests again. And I'm like, well, shit, I've been sitting around all COVID, so it's time to get going.
Same.
I just bought the SheFit bra for my bustier women out there.
Really?
It's definitely worth it. Yep. They don't go anywhere and I've been able to run. And
really?
It's such an amazing bra. Yeah, I love it. I love it.
Okay, I'll have to try that out. I got to write it down because, well, first I had to get my bladder fixed. So I just did that like 6 weeks ago. So I have a few more weeks before I can start running again. But between the bladder fix and the SheFit bra, I'm like, I'm in business now.
Yeah, exactly.
There's nothing holding me back from being
now
like,
I've been running.
Super like back in shape again, which has been a long time. But well, that's a good one. And do you get that online?
I got it online,
Is it like an Amazon thing or do you go to SheFit.com?
SheFit.com, yeah. Okay. You know, and I don't know if there's a military discount. I can't remember if I got that or not, but I think they run promos all the time too. So
cool.
It's an awesome bra. Everyone should buy it.
Thank you. That is these are the answers that I want. I love this. I'm going to look it up.
Thank
just
you.
Like, just like when the one girl was like, my Bondi booster, and I went and bought it that day and I was like, oh, my hair does not look as good as hers did, all crimped like 80s style. So. Well, thank you so much,
thank you
Mother Julie, daughter Jenna, and your brother's name is again?
Jared,
all the J's. Y'all are just an inspirational family, and we think that you are so great. This was so much fun. You're welcome to come back anytime. Now, are you doing any shopping in the area? Like, are you going to go down to Kenosha and shop at Authentic Gifts? You might want to go down there.
That's a great idea.
Yes, we are.
Yes. And then
you
can check in on Eddie and see if he's doing his job.
There we go.
Well, thanks y'all so much. And thank you again for listening to Fearlessly Authentique. We will talk to you next week.
Thank you for listening to Fearlessly Authentique. My mom hopes this episode empowered you to be fearless. Please remember to subscribe wherever you get your podcast. Share, rate, and comment because my mom wants to hear all of your feedback. Contact her directly at fearless@fearlesslyauthentique.com. Hosted and executive produced by my mom, Kimberly Warner, produced and mixed by Steve Hawkins, and co-hosted by Eddie Polanzani. Connect with us on social media via fearlesslyauthentique.com. Copyright Fearlessly Authentique 2020.